There is sample solution. There's 100 ways to solve things. What works in Chicago might be cheaper than what works in Indiana, depending on the price of the steel there and the price of the concrete. Sometimes if you are in Alaska, how are you going to get some materials there? So maybe they will go with steel instead of reinforced concrete. Okay, sometimes there are some places you cannot even get the sand to some places. So sometimes they stay like the ready-mixed concrete truck or mobile mixer. There are some mixers called mobile mixers for casting the concrete, just the concrete, I'm not talking about reinforced concrete. Is you cast as you need. Whatever left, you just take it away. The ingredients are mixed on site and the sand on site. Anyway, so there is behavior. And design. First, we learn the behavior, then we see what's the design. What's the design? And behavior, we're talking about mechanics, pure mechanics. Forces, internal forces, stresses, okay, strain distribution, material properties, the behavior, how the materials behave, and what's the mechanics? What's the mechanism? Then after that, we see the design. Now the design, no more mechanics. We have factors, safety introduced in here. We have simplification. We ignore some terms for safety. Okay, that's the design. That's what those guys do. But based on the mechanical behavior. What are the topics that we will cover in this course? One, beam design. Basically, we're going to design every type of structural member. We have beam, we have slab, we have column, we have footings. Okay, so we're going to start with the beam design. As we are designing the beam, we are learning also the philosophy of reinforced concrete design. And designing, learning beam design will require almost half of this coursework, because you will see the first thing we design in a beam design is flexural design. As you know from connected structural analysis, what do you have? What are the internal forces in beams? The question you used to have in statics or structural analysis: draw the shear and moment diagrams for the following beam. For the frame, draw the shear, moment, and axial force diagram. Right. So beams, usually we ignore the axial force. The internal forces that you have is shear and bending. When I say the word flexure, it means bending. So we have to design beam to resist the flexural forces or the bending coming from the load. So this beam must have a strength or a flexural strength greater than from the induced moments due to this loading. Good? So that's where we start the design. Then we design this beam for shear. Then after that, do we need to check something else? We need to check deflection, which is called serviceability. Now, serviceability has two things. Serviceability. Now, in the guys, most of you took steel design with me. Serviceability was about deflection, right? Did we check anything else? Now we're talking concrete. We're talking concrete. What do we have in concrete? The word cracking. We have cracking in concrete. That's the only difference. By the way, not the only difference. There's two materials, concrete and steel. And the concrete will crack. The steel will yield at a certain point. So it's a composite material now. Not a perfect material with identical stress strain diagram like the structural steel design. Serviceability talks about what? Deflection and cracking or cracking what? Control. We need to control the cracks. We will not allow for certain width or big cracks. Or we need to have a good distribution of the cracks. We would rather prefer to have better distribution of hairline cracks. I mean, you will not see the cracks. By the way, any beam you see, guys, is cracked at the service loads. I will tell you what's the service load, what's the ultimate load. But you don't see these cracks. That's because of the design. The cracks are hairline cracks. Okay? You barely see them. If you go deep, you will see these cracks. But the rim is fine. It's no problem. It's supposed to crack. If the beam will not crack, it means you are wasting a lot of material or money. The beam is over-designed. So serviceability items or terms always deflection and crack control. And we'll see what's the criteria specified by the ACI code to check this. So we start by flexural design, shear design, and check the deflection or serviceability. Or check the serviceability, deflection, and crack control. There's a criteria for the crack control. There is a way to calculate the deflection. We will learn all of that. Now, when I say the word design and reinforced concrete, what do you mean by design? In steel, design was select the section. Why? The question was, select the lightest A992W section for the following beam or for the following column, right? Here, what's the design? When someone is telling you design, it means there is nothing exist. What's given for you? Loading is always given. Loading is giving information. If you don't know the loading, how are you going to design? So the loading is given. From where? Length. How about the length? Yes, the length is given to you from the architect, right? So the length is given, loading is given, supports condition are given for you, unless you want to assume it as a designer. But this is, up to this point, all what I talked about is analysis. Analysis. Design comes after you give me what's the maximum moment, what's the maximum shear, what's the maximum axial force in every member. You take them, these are the ultimate forces, or these are the service load internal forces. Based on the service load, you tell me this is the service load condition. I did not magnify them. Then you come. What do you have? You have dead load, you have live load, you have wind load, you have earthquake load, you have pressure load, you have all these loads. We have load combinations. We have 9 load combinations according to the LRFD. When you have dead load and live load, all of you should know by now that the controlling load or case will be 1.2 dead load plus 1.6 live load. So if the moments were calculated to you based on the service dead load, so you have the moment due to service dead load and the moment due to service live load, ultimate will be 1.2 times the moment due to dead load plus 1.6 times ultimate due to live load, right? Okay. This is the load these are the first two load combinations. The first load combination is 1.4 dead load. The second one is 1.2 dead load plus 1.6 live load. Look at this, as I told you, if we have dead load and live load only, when does this one control the design? I mean, look, when we have load combination, we are looking for the case that will give us the maximum. The maximum potential loading. So when you have those things, just you have dead load and live load, when do you think this one will control over this one? You put them equal to each other. Put those equal to each other. You'll have 1.4 equal 1.2 plus that. You take the 1.2 here, you'll have 0.2 dead load equal that. 1.6 divided by 0.2 is 8. When the dead load is 8 times the live load, this will control. In what situation you have the dead load 8 times the live load? You may have that in huge structure.
Warehouse.
Massive structure.
That's good.
Which one?
A warehouse. I like that.
Warehouse?
Yeah.
Warehouse, usually the live load is huge.
Oh, they said a lighthouse. It's
the live load. We're talking about the case of dead load. The self weight of the member is huge compared to the live load. Like, we have an arch. Not a dam, okay, something like that. When you have an arch, like something built in front of a school, as a statue or something like that, it doesn't have any, nobody's walking in there, it's not carrying anything, but you want this one to be like span way big. So you will have it like an arch or a deep beam. So basically that's carrying its self weight. So basically the live load there is almost zero. Okay, this few situation. In buildings, most of the time when you have dead load and live load, you have that thing. This is the controlling. When you have one, there is another one. Okay? You have those in the handouts or in the book, and we took this in structure analysis, you will have them. And you will have exercise in those. So again, I go back now to the word design. What do you mean by the word design? Analysis, you have all the span. That's a beam. When you analyze this in structure analysis, do you care about the dimensions?
Did we care about that?
We have like a line. That's what we did. We had a line like that with supports at both ends, right? Then we had loads. Dead load, live load, concentrated load, bending moment. This is what you design, right? So you had a line for the structure, right? That's idealization. We call this one the wire structure. For analysis, it doesn't matter. For analysis, you do the analysis, you calculate the internal forces, regardless whether this beam or this member will be steel, will be concrete, will be wood, will be composite material, will be anything, glass, anything. Analysis is analysis. We do idealization with the wire structure. Now when it comes to the design, now design this member to be reinforced concrete. What do we need to come up with? The cross section, basically. What's the cross section? That's one item. When you designed for steel, what was the design? The design was come up with a section that can resist the applied forces, right? For the applied internal forces, for steel design. Here you need to come up with the cross section plus the reinforcement, right? Cross section plus the reinforcement. Now look, if we go to the lab, now here we start, here we go. If we go to the lab and you cast a beam with a cross section, rectangular cross section. Okay, we cast a beam, reinforced concrete beam. I'm going to show you what we have in there. You support the beam like that. What do we call this support condition? When you have bend and roller, simply supported beam. You take it to the tennis also machine, we have it in the lab. You start loading from zero till you crush it. You start increasing the load from zero till you crush it, okay? Till failure. And you are monitoring, you are standing right there or taking video or pictures. What do you see? What's going on at each stage? What do you see? Look, in reinforced concrete, the cross section will look like that. If it's rectangular cross section, and most of the beams are of rectangular cross sections, we will study this one in details. How is that compared to that? The ratios between them, all that. So this is rectangular cross section. Rectangular cross section. We said there is reinforcement. There is reinforcement. Usually, where do you have the steel in beam? Or where do you put the steel? At what location in concrete? Why do we have steel in concrete?
For tension.
Tension, because the concrete will crack in tension, because the tensile strength of concrete is very small. It is ignored, almost. It is equal to 1/10 of its compressive strength. So we consider that concrete strength and tension almost zero. We ignore it. So whenever we have tensile stresses, we need to have reinforcement. And as I said, when the loading is like that under simply supported condition, if the beam length is L, and we have just single concentrated load right there in the middle, P, this will have positive moment. It means positive moment means tension at the bottom, compression at the top. As you see, this will bend this way. It means the bottom part extended, the top part contracted. It means compression at the top, tension at the bottom. So, tell me what's M max? M equal. The maximum moment, if this is in the middle, will be
PL squared over PL over 4.
Okay, listen, you don't have to memorize it. Fast, sharp eye. P over 2. The maximum moment is here. If I cut it here, L over 2. The maximum moment will be P over 2 times L over 2. That's PL over 4. You don't have to memorize it. Right there, in front of you. P over 2, the maximum moment will be here. So if I take a section here, there is no loading in here, the moment here will be P over 2 times P over 2, that's P L over 4. When you have distributed load, you have P W L square over it. But for this case, we have this B element. It's so easy to figure out. So what do we have in the cross-section? You will have reinforcement. Steel rebars or steel bars. 3, 2, 4, 5, 10, 20. Okay? Usually you have them where? In the tension side. We call them deformed steel rebars. They have deformation on their surface. They are deformed. Why? Deformed on the surface. Why? To have
friction
or perfect bond with the concrete. That's one of the major assumptions. That's the first assumption. Perfect bond between the concrete and the steel. Well, how did we achieve that? By the deformed rebar and the friction. Okay? Perfect bond between the concrete and the steel. What does that thing give us? If we have perfect bond, what does it mean? Perfect bond between two things. It means both materials deflect the same amount at the same location. The strain is equal. Look, when you have two materials fully composite to each other, if you apply the load, there will be a strain and deflection. You will not have the concrete going different distance than or different deflection than the steel. Okay. This perfect bond between the concrete and the steel achieved through the deformation of the bars and the friction results in equal strain between the steel and the concrete at the level of the steel. At the location of the steel here, the concrete here will have the same strain. The concrete will have the same strain at the same location. Does that mean the concrete have the same stress? You go back to easy. Guys, everything is easy. Break it down. I'm saying they will have the same strain. Don't answer me. I ask you, do they have the same strain? You say, okay. The law that connects strain and stress is Hooke's law. Sigma equal epsilon E. Right? That's Hooke's law. Just put it there. I said strain in the steel equal strain in the concrete at the level of the steel. Where? Because we have, why? Because we have perfect bond between the concrete and the steel. Okay? Now, I will replace this one with the stress and the modulus. Epsilon S equal sigma S over what? ES. This guy is sigma C over EC. And the question I ask you, do they have the same stress? You tell me, of course not.
No.
The steel will be stressed more. In order to deform the steel the same amount as the concrete, you need to have more stress because it's tougher material. Because this material has more E, elastic modulus. Makes sense, right? So stress in the steel equal E in the steel divided by E in the concrete times sigma C at the level of the steel. I said, I'm talking about the level of the steel. I'm gonna say, why the level of the steel? Because most of our analysis is there. We go to that location for getting the strain, the value of the strain. Look, what does this thing? What's that? It's a modulus over modulus. Look, it's a modulus over modulus. So you want to name it, name it. You can say modulus ratio. We call it modular ratio. Okay? This is, and we refer to this one as N. And if I ask you about N, what's N? From now on, you don't know, you are in trouble. N is the modular ratio. ES over EC. Modular ratio, modulus ratio. Now, what's E for steel? 29,000 KSI. Any student who's in this class knows this one. Or 200,000 megapascal. Now, I'm going to tell you what's megapascal, we don't know. If you want to change from KSI to megapascal, you multiply by 7. Actually, I'm giving you the number, so you don't, 6.895, so 6.9, so say 7. So when I said 29,000 times 7, that's 200,000 megapascal, or 200 gigapascal. Good? Now when I say concrete with compressive strength of 4 KSI, that's 28 megapascal. This is the number 7. Is it too much ball to ask? The number 7. Anyway, most of the units we will deal with is the US system, the inch pound system. So that's the modular ratio. So at the same location here, they have the same strain, but the bars are stressed n times the stress in the concrete. So this is, as you guys said, this is 29,000 KSI, right? 29,000 KSI. Almost this number is constant. Some guys, they take it as 30,000 KSI, but 29,000 KSI. Everybody take it as that in the design. Now, what's E for concrete? For those who just finished 315. E, not F prime C. It has a relationship with F prime C. Easy. It's called what? Anyone knows that? Josh. E for concrete. According to the AC, by the way, this is an ACI code equation in the first chapter or the second chapter. Because it's so easy to test the concrete in compression. You just cast the cylinders and you go there, you crush them, right? You can get the tensile strength of the concrete by beam testing, right? Or splitting tensile, which is an indirect, or direct tension. But usually, you just crush the concrete and crush the concrete cylinders to get F prime C. From there, there's equations by the ACI code. Equations by the ACI code to calculate FR, which is the tensile strength or the modular structure, and E. There's a relationship. And basically, by the way, this is one of the tests, the concrete mix design. You need to compare your results with the specifications. If you don't compare your results with the specification, how are you going to discuss things? How do you know you are good or not? So always compare your results to a specification or standard values, known values. Right? That's how we say our experiment was good. Because we know the concrete tensile strength, as I said, 1/10. And I told you this, right? 1/10 the compressive strength. If you don't get like 2/10 or like 50% of the compressive strength, that's in your concrete. Or there's something wrong in your calculation, or there's something wrong in your machine, right? Now, anyone want to say this one for 1 point in the grade? If you did not look this one up over the net or from the book. From the top of your head, if you know what's this relationship, you have 1 point.
15?
Out of 100.
It's like 7,500. Am I close? 7,500 root?
Not 75, something.
750?
Now.
575?
What, 7, what, 57?
Okay. Root, FC.
Oh, sorry. Next time you're going to get it. You almost have half point somehow. Anytime you see this relationship, guys, in the US system, when you have the square root of F prime C, okay, you plug F prime C in PSI, in pound per square inch, okay? And the result you get for this quantity is in PSI. So when I say this, I always give a trick in the material testing. In the material lab, said for 4 KSI concrete, what's E? The guys will come here and put 4. It's 4,000 KSI. Okay? So you put 4,000 here, you multiply by that. Or you can say to me, Paul will tell me, okay, put this one. Because it's going to be, because this is in PSI, right? I'm going to do it in KSI. So I'm going to do 57,000 times that, but this one has to be in PSI. Anyway, do that for me. If we have 4,000 PSI concrete, how much we gonna get EC? 4. F prime C equal 4,000 PSI EC equal square root of 4,000 times 57,000 divided by 1,000 to get it in KSI because E is here in KSI for steel.
3604?
36? Almost. Let's go with 3600. Good enough. KSI. Now do this for me. 29,000 divided by 36. 8. Almost 8. Almost 8. Goes from 7, 8, 9. We increase this one to 5,000 or 6,000. This E will change. But for normal concrete, E, N is almost 8. The modular ratio is 8. So the bars are stressed 8 times the concrete at that location. Good? topics. We'll cover three topics in the beams design or flexural design of beams. The first one called thinly reinforced beams. From the name, thinly reinforced. What does it mean? The reinforcement is on one side. The reinforcement is on one side. If you have steel on the other side, we call it doubly reinforced. More complicated. So, by the way, singly reinforced, sorry, singly reinforced, as the word here, rectangular beams. Then we will have doubly reinforced rectangular beams. Then we will have T-beams. Then we will cover T-beams. So we're going to start with singly reinforced, the reinforcement on one side. Again, we may have five, we may have two, at least we will have two. At least we'll have two. So those bars, how are we going to cast them? Remember, you have a form, guys. You have a form, a rectangular form. You have the concrete. You know how to make the concrete mix. Now you want to pour your concrete. So how are we going to hold those bars in place? Stirrups. Because, and these stirrups are needed for what?
Sheer
design. These stirrups will be needed for sheer design and in the locations where we don't need it. If the concrete is enough to carry the shear forces, you still need stirrups to hold this in place. So you have stirrups. How are we going to design those stirrups? That's what I said. The shear design. Okay, shear design. The shear design will be, we will know what's the size of the stirrup. For number 10, I'm going to tell you what are the grades for steel. For these sizes of steel or less, use that number. For higher size, use that number. So we know what's the area of the stirrup. So what's the design of stirrups? What's the shear design will be about? Finding the spacing. What's the spacing? What's the distance between the stirrups? Do I put the stirrups at 5 inch, 6 inch, 10 inch? Do I use that spacing all the way? Or do I change the spacing? That's what we're gonna cover in the second chapter of this course, which is shear design. Okay, so we're dealing with singly reinforced. These are the bars, right? Let's use some terminology here. The area coming from these bars is the area of the steel, right? So we're gonna say this is AS, area of the tensile steel. This is what? Area of the tension steel. This bar, these bars are in the tension zone. So they are the tensile steel, or AS. For the compression steel, that the steel in the compression region, we will use AS dash. Later on, you will see. But when I say AS, that's the area of the tensile steel. Now, for the width of the section, what do you guys want to call it? B. For the depth, the overall depth, what did we usually call this one? H. For the distance from the top to the center of the bars, this one here, what do we call it? D. D. The distance from the top here, the compression side, to the center of the bars here, we call it D. So what's left in here? This small part from the center of the bars till the bottom, to the bottom of the section, that's, we call it what? A cover. That's how much we cover, we use over the bars. Right? This is the cover. Cover. It's given. Either standard or the code or the specification will tell you. If your beam is for indoor applications, will not be exposed for carbon dioxide, will not be exposed to contaminated water, use 1 inch or something like that. If there will be contamination, if there is, it's an outdoor application, the cover must be that much. Why? Because we are afraid of corrosion of the bar. So H equal what? D minus the cover. In our calculation, we will use D, and we call D what? D is effective depth. D is the effective depth. When you know D, it means we know H. Because we're just gonna add the cover, it is a given information.
Right. So we're not counting on, we're not accounting for the strength in the cover?
Exactly. You're gonna assume this part here does not contribute at ultimate. Or in our, at ultimate, to the strength. And when I say the word strength, we're talking about the ultimate behavior. Because you will see now, what's gonna happen before a crack? What's gonna happen after cracking? What's gonna happen at the maximum elastic limit? That's the behavior. We're gonna study these regions or these thing before we go to the ultimate. And the ultimate is the one we use for design. Okay? It's the one we use for design. So that's the cross-section. The area of the concrete is almost B times H. The effective area is B times D. And there are some bars in here, which is AS. Now, how much steel we have as a ratio of this area here? I'm talking about the effective area now, which is, as I said, the effective area of the cross-section is what? BD. So how much steel we have with respect to or relative to the BD? What I'm saying, what's AS over BD? You're gonna tell me this is the steel ratio. This is the steel ratio of the cross-section. We're gonna say, what do you wanna call it? Rho, by definition, is the ratio of the steel to the effective area of the cross-section, PD. How much steel we are using? Oh, this is very important because the steel is very expensive material compared to the concrete. The more steel you have, something. And remember, this rho cannot exceed certain value, and that's what the code is telling you, rho max is that much. Cannot be less than certain value. The steel code will tell you, you cannot use less than that much. Reinforced concrete, guys, even there is a minimum reinforcement, there's always raw minimum. And in your design, when you design, you bring, you come up with this and that, the ratio must be greater or equal raw minimum, less or equal raw max. And these are defined for you in the code. Okay, now I assume you guys, before I forget, everybody will buy this one, I assume, or the 14th edition. Okay, we'll assume that. If you can't, just talk to me. The appendix, guys, it's called what? Design aids. You see it? These are aids for the design of almost everything in this. If you don't want to carry this one, it's too heavy for you to carry this one, please, I tell the student, don't come without those. Okay? Don't come without them. If it's too much for you, just take pictures for them on your phone. Because we're going to use this one almost every lecture. Okay? Now, look at the first one. They are talking about the bars, the bar diameter and the area of each bar. Now, what are the bar designations? Which is again chapter 3 in the 315 course, or the material course is what? Steel, right? Chapter 3 is steel, chapter 4 is aluminum, chapter 5 is aggregates, 6 is what? Cement, whatever. Then 7 you come to the concrete, then you go to 8 wood, 9 asphalt, I think, then 10 composite, something like that. But chapter 3 is steel, and there's structural steel, and there is the rebars, and there's designation. Anyway, we're gonna make your life easy. You're going by the number. You go by the number. Now, when I say bar size number 8, you know what does that mean?
1 inch.
Diameter is 1 inch. For number 8, diameter is 1 inch, not the area. The area is given for you. Now, when I say number 5 eighths. Number 3 eight. That's it. Easy like that. The areas are given, an inch square. The designation of number is based on the diameter. It's based on that diameter. When I say number 8, that's one inch diameter. When I say number 9 bar, the diameter is 9A. That bar, number 9, the area is 1 inch square. Anyway, you're gonna get used to this one. Okay? You're gonna memorize the number 8, number 9, because we use those almost all the time. And you will remember number 3 because we use it for the stirrups. So this is the designation and the area of the bar. Table 1 in the appendix. Okay? Don't say I'm going to calculate by d squared over 4. No. It's not. They are not equal. If you are in the field and you just forget it, do that. It will be rough approximate. Okay? You know, if you have 1 inch diameter, you can say, okay, it's circular. So the area is y d squared over 4. No. Different. Little bit different. Okay? So that's the steel ratio. So when I say the word design, you need to come up with B, D, which is H, and the steel. You need to come with B, H, and the steel. If the architect is telling you, hey, listen, you cannot use more than 2 feet. So you have a limitation. And B, you can't fit. B later on, you will figure out. B is, you need to accommodate. You need to have a width that can accommodate the cover and how many bars you have. Now, by the way, our design ended up with 6 bars. And then, by the way, there is requirement for how much you get the bars close to each other and how far you can bring, put them from each other. So if your design calls for 6 bars, and those 6 bars, you cannot have them in one row. The spacing will become too small. And by the way, just for common sense, based on what? How much you can get those close to each other? And the cover is based on what? The aggregate size. If the aggregate is 1 inch or 1.5 inch, if this one is less than that, it's not going to fit. So the aggregate size is one of the things. And the bar diameter. Okay? So what if you don't, if you need 6, what do? You use another layer. Is that thing doubly? No. Doubly means there's a steel in the tension side and the compression side. If you have 3 layers, 4 layers, 2 layers of steel in the tension side, that's singly reinforced. But we had to do that because of the spacing between the bars.
If we have 2 rows of steel bars, the second row is closer to the neutral axis. So
wait,
does it take as much strain?
Later on we'll define that. If you have more than 1 row of steel, D is to the center of all the steel.
Oh, okay.
Okay? Then we will define something else later on, call it D dash. Forget it now. Okay? Forget it. But no, we assume all are stressed the same. And the resultant coming from them is from their center. Good? So these are the terminology. So when I say the word design, you need to come with B, H, and area of steel. With some guidelines. What are the guidelines? The code is telling us there is row minimum, there is row maximum. Okay? There is row minimum, there is row maximum. And also, this later on, you will see when we check the serviceability, the deflection, depend on the depth, right? Depend on the depth, right? Like this one. And depend on what? The deflection, always in the bottom of the deflection equation, what do you have down there?
EI.
E is E. Then there is I. So the higher the I, the lower the deflection. To have higher I, you need to have deeper section because the moment of inertia is pH cube over 12. Right? So this also will control, will be checked when we check the deflection, this will be a factor. And sometimes later on when we cover the serviceability, you may start from there. You may get H that satisfies the deflection. So you don't have to check the deflection. Again, that's what we do for the design of slabs. By the way, we cover design of one-way slab and two-way slab. Okay? One-way slab and two-way slab. Okay, so let's see what's happening as we are loading this beam. From zero to altitude. The first thing you will see, guys, is what? What's the first thing that you can notice, or you will notice? By the way, these bars, they are here. They're going here, right? So I have these boards. Okay, these are the bars at this location. They are inside, you didn't see them. There's one here, the second one, and the third one. So what's gonna happen? You load, we said there's a crack. Did you guys test the beam? Did anybody see a beam tested in the lab? The concrete beam. That's, when it's failed, how does it fail? Two pieces. Psst, suddenly two pieces. Why? Because there is no steel. Once you reach FR, the tensile strength of concrete, fails. Okay? That's why you cannot use concrete as a structural member by itself. It has to be RC. There's nothing called concrete for a structural application. Unless you have massive member and the load is small. And that's why we said reinforced concrete, there is minimum reinforcement. Any structural member must be reinforced minimum. Some applications, especially underground, they release this requirement. Why? Because they are afraid to put the minimum reinforcement there because they may have some corrosion. So they end up with more problems. If the bars corrode, they expand, they crack the concrete. Okay. And by the way, the raw minimum. The minimum is based for what? If you don't need it, why do you have it in reinforced concrete? We call it for shrinkage and temperature. Shrinkage and temperature. Because you will have tensile stresses from shrinkage of the concrete and expansion and contraction due to thermal variation. And these tensile stresses, something has to take them, which is the raw minimum of the concrete. So the first thing you will see is what? Is a crack. Where you think the crack will appear, the first crack will appear? At the maximum moment location, or the location with the maximum deflection, the maximum bending, right? So you will see almost the crack right in the middle, the first crack. The first lecture crack. By the way, how much is the shear here?
P over 2.
The shear here. That's the maximum moment location.
P over 2.
How much is the shear here? Zero.
Zero.
Zero. Maximum moment means the shear is zero. Oh, yes. Okay, you gotta tell me, no, it's not zero. What's his name? Gerard, saying it's not zero. Say P over 2, P over 2. You have the right to say it's not zero. I'm going to convince you now. So P over 2, right? P over 2. You're going to tell me, yeah, it's not zero, right? It's not zero. It's P over 2 positive from here, P over 2 negative from here. No, that's not the case. The load is applied usually on an area. So this is what's happening. This is the load area. So it's there, zero. It's zero there. But it changed from this value, from P over 2 to this one, when a very small length of the beam. What's right there is absolutely zero. The maximum moment is half zero shear. Good? Because this is pure flexure. Then you will see other cracks going this way. Not only that, and this crack will start going. Up. Okay. And you will see cracks here. I'm gonna write that. Then they'll develop here. Now see an angle now. Why? Why there's an angle in here? Because this region, what do we have in here? Bending and shear stresses. So there is a principal stress on an angle. Right? Principal stresses can be calculated from the axial, the flexural stress, and the shear stress with the Q from strength of material from all of them. Okay? Now, look, if there is no steel in here, what's gonna happen to this crack? Shear it. That's the definition of shear. It's a scissor. Cut it into two pieces. Now, look at this step. What's arresting this crack? It's the bars. What is stitching the crack together? Steel. This is the idea of fibers. Sometimes when we have fibers in concrete, when you have hairline crack, very small cracks, the fibers stitch them. It's like you are stitching them with a thread. That's what's happening. Now, as you increase the load, the crack, what's going to happen to it? Open. As the crack opens, you will see the steel. Adding the load, what's happening to the steel? It's extending. What's happening to the strain in the steel? It's increasing, tensile. Right? And as that thing is happening, this is going up. Up. Till this one becomes so close, not enough area of steel, or this small area of steel is so highly stressed, then it's gonna crush. That's what's happening. I'm gonna go on every stage. At what load or at what moment the section will crack? We're gonna call it M. Cracking, MCR. That's the moment at which the section will crack. Crack. Here, the first stage, one, cracking. MCR. Now, just before cracking, what's resisting? Whatever material we have in there. Guys, look, resistance comes from whatever you put there. What materials we have? We have concrete and we have steel. Okay? So that's the resistance coming from those. Just before cracking, what's resisting? That section over there. Right? Now, if, I'm not gonna do that, but if you ignore the steel, what's I? We call it I gross for the concrete. What's I? BH cube over 12. If we ignore the steel, but we're not gonna ignore the steel now. Later on, we may ignore it because it's not gonna be a big factor. But for analysis now, we're gonna keep the steel. Okay, now. Cracking. Now, we're saying, how much this moment? I'm asking you, how much this moment? You're gonna tell me, okay. When the concrete crack, it means the concrete reached its tensile strength. And here we call it FR, which is the flexural tensile strength. It means the concrete reached its FR, which is the modulus of rupture. Good? Now, FR here, guys, look. FR equal modulus, not the modulus of elasticity, of rupture, or flexural tensile strength. Or you want to call it tensile strength came from beam testing. Because you can have the tensile strength from other tests. And they will be different but close. FR. The ACI code is telling you FR has a relationship with F prime C. What's that? 7.5. Good. 7.5 square root of F prime C. By the way, this magnitude here, if you have the 7.5 F prime C, it's almost less than, it's 0.1 F prime C. Almost. Some guys, they take it, 1/10 F prime C, or F prime C over 10. But this is the ACI equation. 7.5 square, it means this is given for us. We said, at cracking that we are looking for here, the concrete stress was almost that. So this is not. Now, this is bending, right? We're talking about bending. What did crack this thing? It's the bending. So what's the bending equation, guys? The bending stress equal what? Sigma. What's sigma? Just from mechanics. I'm talking about I ask you about Hooke's law. Now, the second thing I'm going to ask you about is, what's the bending stress, which is sigma, equal in terms of moment? Bending, it means caused by bending. MC over I, that's the maximum.
MY over I.
MY over I. So you don't forget it. MY over I. And this is maximum wear at the top. Why are we saying Y over I? What's Y? Y is the distance from the neutral axis. Y is the distance from the neutral axis, top or bottom. That's why the sigma over there is plus minus. If in this case, if your y is here, it's compression. If you're taking it down here, the stress is tensile, right? So if y zero at the neutral axis, the bending stress, the definition of the neutral axis is this bending stress is zero. So this distance from here to here we call it C usually. So that's why you're memorizing MC over I, but it is MY over I. Good? I'm way over right. So this is bending, and we are saying this is bending in here. Look, for cracking, guys, so you don't forget it. Look, that's mechanics, right? That's mechanics, right? Look. What's this one here? If this is M cracking, I'm asking you, what's M cracking? So if we just change this one to be MCR, that's the moment that will cause cracking. How much the stress was at the cracking location? Fr. So the bending stress sigma here from mechanics is Fr. What's I? I for everything. If you want to ignore steel, it's I gross, BHQ over 12. So this is I for the section, for the composite section. You will see the steel will add a little bit to the I. Now, what's Y? Where did the cracking occur or started? Here. You're going to tell me, so I'm going to call it C. What's how we distinguish between this and that? Whatever terminology you want to use. The code, sometimes they call this one, if the code called this one C, this distance from here to here, if the book called this one C, so what's our distance in that equation? Look. H minus C. Call it whatever you want. Look. Just call it C tension. The distance from the neutral action, from the neutral axis to the tension phase. Okay, so if you see it in the book, you say, oh, that's different. It's not different. Look at what he's had on the figure. Okay. So now we can calculate Fr. Again, the question is, you will have a question. At what moment this section will crack? Or any given section for you is cracked. If you want to do analysis, guys, when you do analysis, it means everything is given for you. Even the cross-section, the reinforcement. Now they are telling you, at what section do you think this will crack? Okay, let me do my calculation. That's analysis, not design. Design, it means come up with everything. Analysis means the section is given for you and you are analyzing it. You tell him, you think at this load that my beam will crack? I don't like my beam to crack. Someone is telling you. You know, okay, let me see. You may need to make it bigger. So you calculate, I'm cracking for him. You tell him, how much load do you think you are about to let? He will give you the load. You calculate the moment. You tell him, it will crack. He's like that. Now, so this one is known, guys. Assuming that F prime C is always given for the concrete, before you design, look, from the given parameter, as I said, the stress strain diagram for concrete is given. The concrete that you're going to cast this beam from is given to you from the material engineer. Chapter 7, design a concrete mix for that, right? So the concrete strength or the stress strain diagram, which has everything, it has E, it has the strain, it has everything, is given. And the stress strain diagram for the steel is also given to you. So Fy is known, E is known, all the information is known. So the material properties are known. Good for those. So this is known. Well, we want to calculate this one. In order to calculate this one, what do we need? This and that. If, as I said, if I tell you ignore steel, this is known. BH cube over 12. And this is H over 2. Half. If I tell you ignore steel, C will be half. The neutral axis will be right in the middle. So if I tell you ignore steel, how much time does it take for 1 minute or 2 minutes? 7.5 times square of prime C times BH cube over 12 times divided by H over 2.
Yeah,
see? Now, guys, you gotta tell me, oh, that's too much. Some of you will come back and calculate. If I tell you ignore, so easy, guys. Take 1 minute or 2 minutes. If not, it needs some calculation. And that's what we're gonna do. So now we go back to statics. What's the statics? We're gonna come up with what? I for the composite section. We have concrete, we have steel. We need to find I for that. And we need to locate what's the neutral axis in order to find C. And you cover that again in statics and the parallel axis theorem, all of these things. We cover that, right? So, look what's happening. That's the section you have guys, right? Look, I'm going to name it in a minute. That's the section. Is it cracked or I'm cracking? When we calculate M cracking, is this section cracked? No, it's about to crack. It's about, right, is it time?
No, what determines a crack? Like how long or big does a crack have to be?
That's it, it's just hairline crack. It will start, it will go fast. It will stop here, arrested by the steel.
So as soon as you see a hairline crack?
You will see it, yeah, usually when we test, you know what we do? We paint it. We paint this face, or we just spray it. Not thick paint, we just spray it. You will see it right there. And you'll have like two or three students, if you go to graduate studies, you have one, something like that. They will start with the first crack. They mark it. And they put next to it, someone is reading. How much the load? It will put like 15 kip. Then they will have another red marker. Then if this crack extended, they will add that extension next to it. At what load you have that? You say, okay, 18. Then you have one on the other side, one from this side. That's how they observe things, what's happening at every location. Okay? But you will see it right there. Now, look at this section. That we, from this section, we will use this section to calculate the cracking moment. At what moment this section will crack? Again, this section is uncracked, right? It's uncracked, it's about to crack, but before cracking, it was always, right? So uncracked, now, can I just put the steel as is? So I'm gonna take the steel from inside, this steel from inside, and put it here, for analysis. These are the bars, the area of the bars. This is, both of them, guys, not magic, guys, both of them are what? Area of steel, okay? This is the area of steel, gonna tell you what's happening here. Is this the location of the steel? Yeah. I'm gonna take them out of this section. So I have their areas. Is this A area of steel, AS? Do I leave it as AS? Can I deal with two different material in my analysis? I need to transform one into another, right? So we're gonna have transformed, uncracked, transformed. What do you mean transformed? We are going to transfer the area of steel into what? Equivalent area of concrete. Are they equivalent? Look at this. Now, if we have that area of steel in strength, and we are doing strength, we need this I for what? For stresses. In strength, this area of steel, is it equivalent to the same area of concrete? How many times? N times. N times. I showed you. That's why I explained to you. Look at this now. Don't put N. Stop. Don't put N. Don't. We said area of steel. Don't try. When I finish, you will write. So we say N. The area of steel, if you want to transform this area into concrete, it has to be N times area of steel. Because one bar is equivalent to 8, if N is 8, area of concrete. Okay? If this is column of steel, in strength is equivalent to 8. Same size of concrete with a frame C4, 1000 psi. I showed you that. Now, if we do that, what's happening? Well, we have what in here? Stop.
Holes.
We have holes. This section becomes messy. So what do we do? We tell those ends, please give us one from you. Put it back in here. To fill these gaps. And whatever we have in here is what? Look, so easy, guys. This guy of steel is 8 times of those. If you take it from here, you will leave a gap in the concrete. Right? You take one of those, you just plug it back into the concrete. What's left is N minus 1 area of steel. Right, Andrew? N minus 1. Kent? So obvious. In the uncracked transform section, when we have the section cracked, second step, I'm gonna analyze the crack, there will be no concrete. So we'll have the full area of steel. There's no concrete to fill. Okay? Good. So the neutral axis will be, you think, in the middle or below the middle? You know, because we have more area in here. That's your neutral axis. That's your neutral axis. How to calculate the neutral axis? Statics. Now, again, you make mistakes with the statics. Okay, that's B, H, same parameters I gave there for the same definition. So let's calculate let's calculate the location of the neutral axis from top. From here. Or you can do it from here if you want. From bottom or from top. So from top. And let's call this one C. I don't know what's the... It starts C from top or... Doesn't matter. These are just terminal. That's the location of the neutral axis, right? Or you know what? No. Just do that. That, guys. Y bar. That's Y bar. Okay, Y bar equal what, guys? Sum of AI Y bar I from your reference axis divided by sum of
AI.
So each component, look, you don't have to do this, do it engineering way. Forget the math thing. Engineering way. Each component, the area of each component, times the distance from the neutral axis of that component to my reference. Look what I'm saying. This component, we have two components, this rectangle and this piece in here. I'm saying the area of this component, right, which is BH, times the distance from the neutral axis of this component by itself to your reference axis. So the neutral axis of this component is, the distance from here to here is H over 2. Y bar will be for both of them. I'm talking about one of them, one by one. Look, here. It's B, H times second one, plus what? N minus one, AS times what? What? What's this distance from the center of the steel to the top compression? Over there, D. So this distance is what? D minus D. D. Divided by
the sum of the
B H plus N minus one. Yes, that's your Y bar. That's the location. You will have a number. You have a number for that. Once you have that number, you have a number for D, guys, also. Once you have that number, just put them back. Now, what's the moment of inertia of the composite section? Here. So we know, we find this one. So what's I? What do we call I now? U. What's that U blend for? N crack. T. Transform. I, U, T. And you're gonna have ICT, crack transform, equal. One by one, the parallel axis theory says the moment of inertia of a composite section will be the moment of inertia of each individual component plus the area of that individual component times square of the distance from the location of the neutral axis of the composite with the distance from there with the neutral axis of that component. I plus AD squared. I for that plus AD squared. So let's take care of the rectangle. Easy, guys. Just close your eyes and just do it. BH cube over 12 plus BH, that's the area. The distance from the neutral axis of that to the neutral axis of this. It means this small distance here. Just close your eyes, it's going to be squared. It doesn't matter Y squared, Y bar minus that, or that minus Y bar. What is it? What's that level? Doesn't matter if you have y bar minus that, because it's going to be squared. This distance is h over 2, right? And this is y bar. Okay? This is between or y bar minus that. But again, you're going to square it. That's what's coming from this. Plus, now you're going to tell me, okay, it's going to be how much this height. You're going to tell me how much this height, right? Or they're going to tell me that's the air, that's the diameter of the bar. No, we ignore the BH cube over 12. From the steel side, from the steel part, what do we take? AD squared. Only this part. So it's going to be, what's the area of steel? It's going to be N minus 1, right? AS times square of the distance. What is it? D minus Y bar The classical mistake, this is called the classical mistake. Most of the students, everywhere, they forget the square for some reason. That's the parallel axis theorem. Now, guys, do you have IUT? Yeah? Now, what's M cracking? Look, what do we have so far? We have FR equal MCR Y to the tension divided by I. We said this is now IUT, and crack transform, right? And this one will be, in our case in here, is what's that? What's the distance from the neutral axis of the composite section to the bottom? The neutral axis of the composite to the bottom. Here, you want M cracking, right? You want M cracking. Keep it on one side. M cracking equal FR, which is a given, which is known, times IUT, you have it there, divided by what? YT, which is, what is it here? Four. What's it? The distance from here to the steel or to the bottom, where's the crack going to start? Bottom. So what's that? H minus Y bar. Minus my power. Good? H minus my power. Look, when you deal with a problem like that, before I move on, usually FR, you have it in what, guys? In PSI. R per square inch, right? And B and H are in inch, right? So your I is calculated in inch to the power 4. And the distance there, this distance here, is an inch. And we know the unit of a moment, we know the unit of a moment is force times distance. All the forces, all the quantities with the force in this formula were in pound. The only thing come with the force is from the stress, which is pound per inch squared. So the forces were in pound, right? And the distances and the areas were in the inch unit. So I'm saying it's force times distance. So the unit of the moment will be in inch pound. Inch pound. Usually, an inch pound, the moment is huge. You wouldn't even have a sense for it. We always like to go with kip foot or foot kip. So you divide by 1,000. You change the inch to foot, you change the pound to kip. At the end, usually, you divide by 12,000 to get the moment in kip foot or foot kip. Good? And then, later on, we're going to take an example. I'm going to focus on this one. Good? Good? That's the cracking moment. That's how to calculate it. Yeah. The cracking moment. Is it time?
Yeah.
Okay. Just want to tell you one statement and you can go. So one now after cracking. So that's called cracking. Then there's what's happening after cracking. After cracking, look guys, so there's something missing in imagining what's happening. After cracking, the crack will start. The crack will go some distance. How much? Later on you will know. Based on how much steel you have, based on the strength of the concrete, the crack can go halfway, one third, all the way, based on how much steel you have, based on the properties you have for the beam. Good? So once you have a crack, look what where I'm analyzing. I'm analyzing right there at the crack. I'm taking the section to analyze right there at the crack location. So when there's a cracking, what do you see? I'm going to start from here next time. What do you see? What's the section look like after a cracking?
Just
after cracking, what do you see?
Concrete on the top and then
there is area of concrete still. What did not crack? Still the crack at certain level develop. This area above the crack Still, cracking did not occur. Right? Cracking did not occur. So there's an area of steel in compression. And that's what's here is what? A neutral axis. Your neutral axis shifts up. So on the compression side, because it's bending, we have this area left. What do we have at the bottom? We ignore concrete intention. So the concrete intention is gamma. So what do you have in here? AS. When we transform this one, this will be NAS. We don't have to have it N minus 1 because there is no concrete in here. So that's your section. That's the cracked section. What's this one here? B. What's this one here? Is it H over 2? Is it H? Of course not. Is it D? Of course not. It went up. You're going to tell me it's a fraction of D. You can tell me it's a fraction of D. We don't know how much. So we're going to call this one KD, where K is a factor. Less than 1. Greater than 0, of course. So that's your section. Once you have that, when you have the section given, when the area of steel is given to you, and is given to you, can you find KD? Yes, you can. Can you locate this one? Yes, we can. Sum of the moment of the areas above the neutral axis equals sum of the moment of the areas below the neutral axis. What's the distance from here to here, guys?
It's D minus KD.
So easy, guys. It's D minus KD. This is D. This is KD. This is D minus KD. So it's going to be, look, B. Look at this and you can go. Look at this and you can go. B times KD times KD over 2, that's the moment of the areas above, or the neutral axis, equal NAS times D minus KD. What's the only unknown in here? K for analysis. You find K. Good. We'll start from here.